invitation. It's always a pleasure to be in Brazil. So I will talk about a subject that is different from what I was doing before, but some already two, we had already two talks about it. I went to this topic when I met with Kieron Malik, because he was actually working in this. Kieron Malik is a statistical physicist, so we kind of exchange techniques. I learned statistical physics from him, and I teach him semi-classical methods. And also, I kept collaboration with Alfredo, of course. So the plan is the following. So first, I will again talk about classical Jarzynski presentation basics. Although it was said before, I will probably say it in a different way. And of course, I will talk about the quantum counterpart, because it's what we are interested in. And I will try a different approach from what has been done this morning. I will try in the viral representation. And I will show you that some kind of trajectories appear, which make it easier to understand what's happening, and maybe to calculate concrete things, but this I haven't done yet. Probably everybody, this is a basic, this is a initial step of the natural initial step from Jarzynski inequality. You remind the textbook inequality from between work and free energy, right? Like you have two one initial point, one final point, and you make many different trajectories. You can have many different trajectories, and work depends on the trajectory. And there's a second principle says that work is bounded from below, and the bound is free energy, right? So Jarzynski made a generalization of this inequality in the 90s, and the first step was already to wonder what is microscopical work, because this work is microscopic, right? And we are talking about microscopic work, which is already something which is not obvious, actually. So then we redefine the work as the average of the microscopical work, which I will define later. And this has been said already. So we start from an initial state, which is a Gaussian state, right, a thermal state. And we propagate in a way which is non-adiabatical, like irreversible in general. And you end up with a different distribution, which is in general not a thermal state, it's not a Gaussian. And you take the average of the exponential of minus the work instead of taking the average of the work. And this gives you the exponential of minus beta times the free energy, which is also the ratio between the the ratio between the final partition function and the initial partition function, because it's a Hamiltonian which depends on time, so there is an initial partition function and a final partition function. I will remember later. So one first problem of the Jarzynski equality is that what is it used for? So it took me some time to understand the purpose of this equality. And it's a part of a big family of problems which is called the fluctuation theorem, which is kind of generalization of second principle, right? But the purpose is to do like thermodynamics away from equilibrium, because you know that regular thermodynamics is at equilibrium. And the purpose is to try to build some thermodynamics far from equilibrium. And for this, there is a fluctuation theorem, for instance, that says that look at the probability of going in the right direction in the sense of second principle compared to the probability of going in the wrong direction. And the ratio of the probability is exponentially small. And it's very similar to this Jarzynski equality or the Crookes theorem, which is related to it. So here it would be about the probability of having a work, positive work, and the probability of having a negative work. What can we get concretely from the Jarzynski equality? Where we can have experimentally, usually the purpose is for system where we don't know the free energy, but we can measure work. Then we can compute some free energy, like what something that we interpret as a free energy as a function of the irreversible work. So we can do some kind of generalized thermodynamics. And also, the Jarzynski equality can be interpreted as a characteristic function, generating function of fluctuation relations, like a Kubo relation, for instance. I think this is interesting. So I said the microscopic work is already a difficult thing. Microscopically, you know that you have a system, and you have an environment, and you know that you receive some work and some heat, and you can say that the work received from the environment is minus the work received from environment by the system, right? So it's a very well-defined quantity. I mean, it's but as long as you go in a microscopic, it's not true anymore. Imagine you have a two-particle system, or like a system which is separate like that, with the system, environment, and the interaction. Then you would say, okay, maybe the interaction corresponds to the force that the system receives from environment. And if you do that, of course, the force from environment to the system is still minus the force from system to environment. It's just Newton's law, right? But the work is not reciprocal. Actually, the energy actually is for environment. The energy is partitioned from system interaction and environment, and it's not clear. The environment can exchange energy with the interaction, and the interaction can exchange energy with the system, but it's not. It doesn't have to be an equal footing, right? So there is already a difficulty in defining what is work at the microscopical level. What's the difference between work on heat, for instance? The answers usually are stochastical. Like you have a stochastic dynamics with a drift and with a dissipation and with a noise. Here it's just for to have a picture in mind, right? The natural, what people usually do is to say, okay, what depends on time is the work, because when there is no, it's what I force when I'm trying to modify the system, in a deterministic way, then I call this the work. And what is the random is the heat, basically, right? So the heat is the difference of energy minus the work. Which is, of course, related to the average square of this quantity, for instance. But there are different conventions, Ito and Stratonovich, and then there is a difference in the heat. But the work is always this quantity. So this is this work that we are going to use. And then the Jarzynski equality. if you use this work, then there is a Jarzynski equality. Here I will give you a simple proof of Jarzynski equality because it's quite instructive of what how it works. So here it's an system without heat, so like a Hamiltonian system. And you have a thermal state and you average over the exponential of minus the work. And here, since it's a Hamiltonian system, the work is exactly the difference of energy, right? Like you throw out so many trajectories, and every trajectory change energy because it's a time-dependent Hamiltonian, and the difference of energy for each trajectory is the work received in this trajectory. Don't forget that the trajectories mean is different realization because it's you got an initial state which is where there is many initial conditions with the distribution, right? So every trajectory is a complete system where you have a certain evolution and then you do many realization and it gives you this average. And then from there it's quite obvious, right? Because this quantity cancels this quantity, so only remains this one. So it looks like, ZT reminds that ZT is a exponential, is an integral of exponents of minus H, right? So it looks like we are almost there, right? It's kind of obvious. But there's still something, like here it's X of T, and here it's X naught. So it's not exactly the same integral, right? So we need still one more step, and here we use symplecticity to make a change of variable, and then dxt dx naught is equal to 1 because it's symplectic, and then we get the partition function, right? So in this case, it's quite simple. And you see that here we need this symplecticity. So here we can see already, we can have a flavor of what it means, the Jarzynski equality, because we kind of associate the second principle through these states, right? It's a thermal state, right? So there is a Boltzmann factor which is included, so there is a second principle already. And we associate second principle with something about time, right? Symplecticity is something which is conserved in time. So we kind of delocalize the second principle, right? But here, it's in this case, it's very simple. In the more general case, the proofs are more complicated, of course. But what replaces symplectic is general, in many proofs, is detailed balance. And the spirit is basically that locally the state remains locally invariant, right? I mean, locally it's an equilibrium, but there is a time change of the system, so globally it's not invariant, but locally it's invariant. And this is the what needs the Jarzynski equality. Right? So time goes fast. Right? So now at the quantum problems, there is another kind of problem. There was already a problem of in classical problem, in the classical representation of the problem. So in the quantum energy, there is another problem, is that if I want to do the same, like a function of t, it's already a problem in quantum mechanics. Well, people usually start from this point, but if you think about it, here it's, I don't need this for the final result, for what I will say later, but I think it's interesting to see that already what I define h of t is reposes on some grounds that the system is well separated from the environment. Because like in the classical case, typically the potential is corresponds to the interaction potential where I fixed the x2 position of the particle as a parameter, for instance. Like the system has defined trajectory, and from this well-defined trajectory, it gives me a well-defined potential, right? So I cannot do that in quantum space because I could be a new superposition of states in the environment, and a superposition of state environment would give me a superposition of potential, right? Of quantum potential. So I need first to assure that I'm in this kind of state where it's a product of the system state with the environment state. And usually the Jarzynski equalities, they hold in this kind of configuration. And for instance, it works. We did some work also with Kjorn and the other people too did that. In the Limblad equation, we can do something about the Jarzynski equality also because we are in this configuration. So now I assume that I have a well-defined h of t. This morning you got usually people look at the two-point measurement in this case to say something about quantum Jarzynski. They say okay, we make first a measurement and then a measurement at the end, and we look at the difference of energy, and this is work in the case where there is no environment. If there is environment, you can do something also, but you have to measure what is the heat. So basically, the picture is the following: you got the eigenstates of your system, which change in time. Usually, we say that the work is basically the evolution of the eigenstate, and the heat is the jump between the two eigenstates, for instance. So in Limblad equation, we can do something because as a jump, we can know exactly what the jumps do in the Limblad equation. And then in the Limblad equation, we can actually show that the work is basically can be interpreted as a term that you are adding to the Limblad equation, so that the thermal state becomes a solution of the Limblad equation, because you know that if I forgot dependence on T here. If the thermal state the thermal state is not a solution of the Limblad equation in general, because it cancels out this part, right? The thermal state cancels this part, obviously, because H commutes with the thermal state. And it cancels out this part because of the detailed balance hypothesis. Right? Detailed balance hypothesis says that it's a local equilibrium of the thermal state, which means actually that the Limbladian part cancels out. So everything cancels out, but what does not cancel out is this part, because of course it depends on time, so the thermal state is not a solution of the Limblad equation. But if you add this, if you add a term, you can make it become again a solution of the Limblad equation. And this term is what you interpret later as a quantum work, which can be associated with the two-point measurement work, but only on this portion, right? Like there is a two-point measurement work, and then there is a jump, and then there is two-point measurement work, and so you can say it's like a continuous measurement of energy of the system, because Limblad equation is a continuous measurement process. Environment is continuously measuring the system. And in particular, it's continuously measuring the energy of the system, and then you can define some kind of operator. What is funny, what I found interesting, is that this term actually is used by certain experimentalists when they manage to realize it experimentally. Then they use it to cool down systems faster than the adiabatical process, because to cool a system, you wait that it cools down, right? But if you add this term, if you are able to add this term, you can just follow the thermal state, and then you can cool down the system much faster. But they don't use exactly this operator, because they cannot realize it experimentally in general. But sometimes for instance, in the harmonic oscillator case, it's almost the same, right? What I will do, I will not talk about this two-point measurement semiclassical expression. I will try to do something else, which will go in viral representation, because you've noticed probably that it's naturally, I mean, the Jarzynski equality naturally relies on trajectories, right? So in the viral representation, we can have trajectories. So that's why what motivated us at the beginning. And actually, the result is I find it quite quite interesting. But I don't know if it's interesting for Jarzynski, but I think it's quite, at least it's quite nice to look at. But I don't know. I think the it doesn't work really well. This, but do you hear me? I like to present the viral representation in this way. Usually, people present it this way. I realized recently a very simple stuff that usually, by correspondence principle, you have a PQ coordinates, right? And you just quantize, you put a hat on them, right? And a viral representation is just you quantize this, actually, which is kind of obvious when you think about it, but. Actually, I thought about it recently, so I find it's nice to represent the viral quantization by choosing to quantize this instead of quantizing this. So you quantize the plane wave, right? So you take a function of P and Q, you take Fourier transform, and you Fourier transform back, and then instead of putting P and Q, you put P hat and Q hat. So P hat and Q hat replaces the P and Q in the Fourier transform, which I find it interesting. And of course, there is if you compute the reciprocal formula, then you actually can end up with this formula, which is the usual one, which is presented, right? Okay. So this is viral quantization. So first, we try to look what is. There is already a problem, an interesting problem, which has been looked at already. It's that you've got this thermal state. What is the viral representation of this thermal state? As you probably know, it will not be exponential of minus as a classical Hamiltonian, because as you probably know, the viral representation does not conserve the product, right? If you have a product of operator, then the transform of the product is not a product of the transforms. So a fortiori, with the Hamiltonian where there are many products, the viral transform of an exponential of an operator is not the exponential of the transform of the operator. But we can still put it here. It's just a notation. I just put it in the form of the exponential of a function. And we can imagine that in the semi-classical limit, the j is equal to h. Right? In the case of harmonic oscillator, we can compute the sum exactly. And it's quite instructive to do it. So the transform is, the calculus is based on this nice formula that the generating function of the Laguerre polynomials, and the Laguerre polynomials are the viral representations of the Fock spaces, right? Projector on Fock spaces. So this thermal state is the distribution on Fock spaces. I mean, Fock spaces are the eigenstates of the energy, right? And every Fock space has a Laguerre. The viral representation of the Fock space is the Laguerre polynomial, and since the generating function of the Laguerre polynomial is this function, then you just replace t by exponential minus h bar omega, and then you get this expression, right? So this is a quantum thermal state, and this is a Weyl representation of the quantum thermal state. You can recognize the classical Hamiltonian here, which is just multiplied by the by coefficient, which is a hyperbolic tangent of x over x, where of beta h bar omega over 2 divided by h bar omega over 2. And it's quite natural. Like here, you can see that if temperature beta is very small, or very, if temperature is very high, if temperature is very small, then the Gaussian becomes very narrow, of course. And here, if temperature becomes very, very small, then this converges to 1. So the distribution just remains with the width h bar omega over 2, right, basically, which is what we expect from a quantum state, right? Like that it cannot go below h bar omega over 2. Of course, it's interesting to see what happens for more general Hamiltonian. So here, I got the idea to use the Van Vleck propagator in imaginary time, right? Which is a standard thing done, which is done in statistical physics. I mean, every time there is a temperature, it can be interpreted as a imaginary time, right? It's a standard thing. I don't know if it was done with the Van Vleck before, but okay, that's what I have done. So instead of taking, take the same action of the Van Vleck propagator, and I replace time by the imaginary time. Here, I start from T0. So since the time is beta, right, you have to interpret this as beta. So there is no initial time because time is not really a time. So there is no obvious initial time. So I can choose whatever I want as an initial time. So far, I use just T0, T0. And then I integrate until T naught plus A h bar beta. And this gives me this semi-classical thermal state, right? I mean, I can interpret this as a semi-classical propagator. And then exponential minus j that I was looking for is the Weyl representation of this expression, right? And of course, from this I can do semi-classics because I mean a stationary phase, right? So one point, important point, is that the action is the action along a imaginary time trajectory. Which is driven by this equation. So it's a Hamilton equation, but except that u is imaginary time, right? And now I can do phase space, of course. And it's not very complicated. It's just a regular thing, except that it's in the complex space. So it's a bit like the semi-classical propagator of the Wigner function, right? But in the complex space, so the stationary point is that p and q, which are the variables of the function, should be the midpoint of the initial and the final trajectory. I mean, of the initial and final point of the trajectory. And so you get the picture here. So the red trajectory is the imaginary time trajectory, and here is the real plane. So the imaginary time trajectory crosses the real plane, and then the midpoint is the plane where I measure the Wigner function. I mean the Wigner function of this distribution of the thermal state. So I want to know what's the value of the Wigner function of the thermostat at this point. I need to compute this imaginary time trajectory, and then it gives me the expression of J, right? Ah, yeah, one important thing is that P and Q must be real because they are the point where I measure the Wigner function. So it forces, kind of, so forces me to adopt T naught as something which is on the other side, like to have a symmetry plus and minus, a complex symmetry, like the initial position is the complex conjugate of the final position. So this fixes the initial time, right? And okay, so now I get this expression for the argument of the exponential corresponding to the Wigner function of the Gaussian state, which is the usual Hamiltonian, the classical Hamiltonian, but taken not at P and Q, but P naught and Q naught, which is this point, right? Which is slightly, there is a difference of size h bar square between this point and this point. So it's like you shift the position of the classical energy, and you're adding some area, which is the area of this trajectory, right? So this is a first order correction, right? Which is also of order h bar 2. Okay, now we want to do Jarzynski analysis. So, in Jarzynski, we interpret the work as the integral of the derivative of H, right? So here, that's why we got interested in the derivative of J. Here we can do, it's what I find more interesting, actually. It's that you can do a perturbation theory, right? Because you change T of, you change H very slightly because you change from T to T plus delta T. So it's a real, we are really in the condition of perturbation theory. So it's a standard result of perturbation theory. The G dot is actually the integral of H dot, of classical H dot, on the imaginary path. So it's the average of H dot on the imaginary path, right? Because that's the only path that changes in time. So I will call it this way in the following. I put two instead of one to not to confuse to real averages, right? So it's an average of H dot over imaginary arc. So is this, the Wigner representation of the thermostat is the exponential of minus this average, okay. And from there, I can do, I'm in the context of Jarzynski proof, right? Because I can do exactly what I've done at the beginning, you know, here. The equivalent of the Jarzynski equality is this, right? It's the integral of the initial distribution, which is the Wigner function of the thermal state, of the initial thermal state, times exponential of minus beta times the integral of the average of H dot, which I can interpret as the work in the viral representation. And this is equal to exponential of minus j at time t, of course, because this was g dot. This g dot, so here it's just exponential of minus g at time t, and then I recover the partition function. So I got, I call it pseudo-Jarzynski because it's not really work, right? But it's just has the same shape, right? since here the H is depending on time, And here it was not depending on time. So here it was just the arc. Here I have to add also the propagation, the classical propagation, because I integrate over the classical time, the real time, I mean. And so it gives me this trajectory. So it's the P and Q is not anymore the middle of this arc, it's the middle of this arc propagated with a real time. This we are basically here, right? So we don't really know where it leads to. I mean, the class, the physical interpretation is not really clear. But of course, the h bar limit of this is the classical Jarzynski equation, because the Bose trajectory will collapse to the real trajectory, and then we get back to the classical Jarzynski. So it's a natural deformation of the classical Jarzynski. Maybe I will talk about this first, where we can wonder what is the average of H dot. So in the harmonic oscillator, it is this expression. And it happens to be the same expression as this operator that we must add in the Lindblad equation in order to have the quantum Jarzynski in Lindblad equation, right? So it's the same operator, it's kind of natural because Weyl representation is just a representation, right? So the same objects, but we got just their Weyl representation. There's something tricky because of this story of products, that it's not exactly, actually, it's not exactly the same function. It's H dot average is the function at Q naught, and the Weyl representation of this operator is this function also, but at Q, at position Q. So there is still this story about decaying between this point and this point, right? Which is just because of this story of products of operator, that when you go in the Weyl representation, it's not the product of, and this has this consequence. At least it's exactly this in the harmonic oscillator. I don't know if it's so simple in the most complicated case. So I was wondering if we can do something out of this, because we sort of found it. It's nice. It's nice looking, but we don't really know if it's really useful. But so we started looking about the fluctuation relations, because we are supposed to derive fluctuation relation from this equality, right? And here I will follow like a paper from Boshkov in 77 on Kuzovliev. Well, it's a derivation. You basically, it's like Kubo relation, right? You take the Jarzynski relation, and then you make an integration by part, so the dot goes here. And then you change variables from Q naught. Here you back propagate the operator, right? So I make a change of variable. So here it was the final position. P is the final position as compared to P naught. But the integration is over the final position. So now I integrate over the initial position. And now I take derivative, like a functional derivative at time, at some time, and then the functional derivative of this object is equal to zero because it only depends on the final position. It only depends on the final state, and I'm taking derivative about on something that happened in the middle of the path. So this is equal to zero, yeah? But it's also equal to the derivative of both terms, like this term and this term, which are not equal to zero. So the derivative of this one gives this. as a derivative of this one gives this. So it's a fluctuation relation. I'm not very familiar with fluctuation relation, but it's basically the same as what is derived in the Boshkov paper, except that instead of the classical Q dot here, we got the average over the imaginary trajectory. And here is the same object. So it's just a different, and it's supposed to be, of course, the perturbation of the quantum Kubo relation, a quantum fluctuation relation. Okay, well, this is basically everything I was going to say. So, okay, this is a summary. We got thermal states. So we got complex trajectory to in order to rebuild the same structure as the Jarzynski equality proofs, right? I don't know what we can do with it, but we can derive some fluctuation relation. I don't know if the fluctuation relation are useful, more like easier to compute than the, but I've heard that quantum fluctuation relation can be difficult to compute for a realistic system, so I have no idea. But here, the imaginary trajectory are not very bad because they are not large time, right? You start from the real plane, you propagate a little bit, and at high temperature, it's a small deviation. High temperature, you get a little bit further, but it's just forward propagation, right? So, okay, I thank you for your attention.
Thanks for the nice talk. So, questions, comments?
You have shown a very simple derivation of the Jarzynski